Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.
Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه وبعد. All praise is indeed due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless every single one of us, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us every form of goodness. Allahumma la ilma lana illa ma 'allamtana innaka antal 'alimul hakim. O Allah, we do not have knowledge besides that which you have granted us, for indeed you are the owner of knowledge, the owner of wisdom. Allahumma inna nas'aluka min ilmik. O Allah, we ask you to grant us from the knowledge that you have. Allahumma inna na'udhu bika min ilmin la yanfa' wa min 'aynin la tadma' wa min qalbin la yakhsha' wa min du'a'in la yusma'. O Allah, we seek protection from knowledge that is not going to be made use of, and we seek protection from eyes that will not cry for your sake, and we seek protection from a heart that will not tremble in fear of you, Ya Allah, and we seek protection from a stomach and a soul that will not be filled and content, and we seek protection from a dua or a prayer that we make that is not answered. Allahumma allimna ma yanfa'na wanfa'na bima allamtana. O Allah, grant us knowledge of that which is beneficial, and benefit us from the knowledge that you have granted us. Ameen. Honored ulama, beloved brothers and sisters, the topic tonight is none other than knowledge, as we can see. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the owner of knowledge, to grant us knowledge that is beneficial. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to be from amongst those who can earn the knowledge of this deen, the knowledge of this religion, the knowledge of the spirituality that is required of man, the knowledge of himself, the knowledge of the life after death, and the knowledge that will make us earn paradise, the knowledge that will protect us from hellfire. That having been said, we also ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us enough knowledge that we can pass our time in this world meaningfully, inshallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from that which is a waste of time, and that which is meaningless, and that which is destructive. Ameen. Honored ulama and beloved brothers and sisters, once again, I'd like to remind one and all that Allah, the Almighty, the creator of myself and yourself, is the owner of knowledge. He is the one who decides who is going to get what type of knowledge. It is Allah's supreme independent decree. So if someone has a certain type of knowledge, it is because Allah decided that He would permit them to have that. And He chooses people whom He wants to have religious knowledge. Allah selects them very carefully. And that is a test for them and a test for us as well, the laymen. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those whom, when we have knowledge, we can put it into practice and teach it to others. It is an amana, it is a trust entrusted to us. The idea is to impart it. If anyone is to block or cover or stop or hinder the knowledge of Islam, they are sinful, and they are from amongst those whom Allah will not speak to on the day of Qiyamah because of His anger with such people. So the knowledge of religion is not copyrighted, because it belongs to the Creator Himself. The knowledge of the Qur'an and the Sunnah does not belong to one person. It is not patented to anyone, and we cannot hinder the spread of Islamic knowledge in any way. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala selects and chooses the people He wants. A test for them to put it into practice, to teach it to others. A test for those who don't have it, to respect those who have it. To respect the knowledge, if not the individual. Which means sometimes the individual might err, but the knowledge he has needs to be respected. And this is why we should never ever harm or scoff at or joke about any of the scholars of Islam. because we will be digging our own graves and we will be calling for destruction for ourselves. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. The ulama, those who have learnt the knowledge of Allah, they work for Allah. They are the slaves of Allah. Their owner is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have dedicated a large chunk of their lives for the sake of the Creator. If anyone harms them, the Creator will revenge. They won't be able to revenge. Allahu Akbar. So it is more dangerous to harm a scholar of deen than to harm anyone else, though both of them are prohibited. And this is why the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "Man aada li waliyan faqad aadhantuhu bil harbi." Whoever has harmed a friend of mine. And who are the friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? They are those who are struggling and striving to get closer to Him by recognizing Him and putting into practice whatever they have learned and teaching it to others. Those are the ulama of this ummah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. Indeed, those who truly fear Allah, who are truly aware of the Creator, are those who have knowledge. Those who have sound knowledge. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to respect the knowledge that they have. And that's why I was saying that moments ago I was saying that when a scholar of this deen who is not a prophet, the prophets are sinless, they are perfect. But when the scholars of Islam have erred in terms of this world, then we will correct them politeness, with full politeness, alhamdulillah, and with respect, with utmost respect. We will not spread rumor about them because Allah will create people to spread rumor about us. We will not make life difficult for them because Allah will create people who will make life difficult for us. We will not harass them because Allah will immediately create people who will harass us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those who can respect those who have knowledge. And that is the way we will be achieving knowledge. Knowledge is achieved when a person respects those who have knowledge. And this is why we are taught that the one who has taught you anything, you need to respect him right to the end and even beyond the end. Where we are meant to really be from amongst those who can respect and look up to a teacher of ours, no matter what goodness they've taught us, we are meant to respect them. Without respect of the teacher, you will learn absolutely nil. You will have complete blessingless knowledge. Knowledge that will result in your detriment and downfall, and not knowledge that will be beneficial. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever learns knowledge in order to boast and brag and to debate and argue with those who don't have knowledge and to show their knowledge to those who do, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they can kindle their place in the fire of Jahannam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Allah says they will not smell the scent of heaven. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says they will not smell the scent of heaven if they have learned the knowledge for the wrong reasons. And this brings us to the first point. We need sincerity when it comes to seeking knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of knowledge. In Surah Az-Zukhruf, the verses we read tonight, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَهُوَ الْحَكِيمُ الْعَلِيمُ. He is the owner of wisdom, the owner of all knowledge that is beneficial is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really grant us the ability to acknowledge and accept that and to plead for good knowledge from Him, because He is the owner of knowledge. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs us of how important knowledge is. If a person has knowledge, it is more important for him to impart that knowledge than his own life, subhanallah. Because if a person passes away without having imparted knowledge, they have done a great disservice to the ummah. Whereas as soon as they've learned something, they put it into practice and quickly pass it on, inshallah, that will then spread. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the knowledge of the Quran before He speaks about the life of man and the creation of man. In the opening verses of Surah Ar-Rahman, listen to what He starts with. And it's not a coincidence, it is intentional from Allah the Creator. He says,
Ar-Rahmanu 'allama al-Qur'ana khalaqa al-insana 'allamahu al-bayan.
He is the most merciful. He has taught, indeed, He has taught the Qur'an that is recited, the knowledge. It is Allah who has taught it. So Allah makes mention of the teaching of revelation. Then he says, he has also created man, subhanallah, which means my life is not as important as the knowledge of this deen. And what that would mean, or part of what that would mean, is that if I am holding any knowledge, I better make sure that I pass it on before I go. The hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, بَلِّغُوا عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. Relay from me, convey from me, even if you have a single verse, teach it to others and spread the good news. It is our duty to spread this good news and to spread the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then after saying he has created man, he says he taught him eloquence. He taught him how to convey himself, how to portray what he would like to utter. It is Allah who taught man the eloquence. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to utter whatever we have to in the most respectable and dignified manner. And may he make us from those who can only utter that which is beneficial for both ourselves as well as those we are uttering it to. And may he protect us from anything that is evil. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Alaq, he speaks about the pen and how he has taught man how to write, and he has taught with the pen. Just picture it for a moment from the beginning when Adam alayhi salam was created. They did not used to write by pen at that particular time, but Allah taught them how to do that. And Adam alayhi salatu wassalam was a person created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had his brain, the brain of Adam alayhi salatu wassalam, already packed with whatever software it needed, subhanallah. When you have a computer that is empty, you need to put in all the disks and you need to program it and you need to put all the software. Adam alayhi salam, if we can use the words just to bring it closer to our understanding, he was packed with every software we could dream of. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Al-Baqarah,
وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا.
We taught Adam alayhi salatu wassalam the names of absolutely everything. Allahu Akbar. So unlike us, when we grow up, Allah says,
وَاللَّهُ أَخْرَجَكُمْ مِنْ بُطُونِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ شَيْئًا.
When Allah took us out of the wombs of our mothers, we didn't know anything, nothing at all. But when it comes to Adam alayhi salatu wassalam and Hawa alayha salatu wassalam, those two were an exception. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had already taught them. There was another exception, and that was Jesus, may peace be upon him. He was also taught the language from the cradle. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala miraculously permitted him to speak. When they asked him, who are you? Or when they looked at him in a questioning manner, he responded, I am not the son of God, I am the worshipper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I was created through the Virgin Mary in a miraculous way. That is what he uttered, subhanallah, as a miracle. And still there are people who deny that he was actually the worshipper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, this is something amazing, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam. As soon as he had life, he could speak, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the pen in Surah Al-Alaq, and he says,
الَّذِي عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمْ عَلَّمَ الْإِنسَانَ مَا لَمْ يَعْلَمْ.
It is Allah who taught by the pen, and he taught man what man did not know. That is a powerful point as well. Imagine the books of history are recorded and they are brought forth for all of us. If man was unable to read or write, what would there have been for us to read and write, subhanallah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given man the power to record knowledge, whether it is via CD or via a small chip or via a 32 gigabyte microchip. That is all Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's permission. He gave man that knowledge. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala amazingly has the knowledge according to the times. Amazing, subhanallah. There was a time when people were unlettered. Unlettered meaning they could not read or write, but they were extremely knowledgeable because they had a memory, subhanallah, that was not given to us. You take a look at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was the most knowledgeable. He had the most knowledge from amongst the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he was unlettered. He couldn't read nor could he write. That brings us to a powerful point. Reading and writing does not necessarily mean you have or do not have knowledge. Allahu Akbar. You could have the neatest handwriting, but you could be as thick as a brick. May Allah protect us.
And you could be able to read so quick, but you could have no knowledge whatsoever. Allahu Akbar. And there are people from amongst our forefathers and maybe even in our midst who are known as those who use a thumbprint when they are signing because they can't hold a pen. And at times they have more knowledge than all of us put together. Subhanallah. Because Allah is the owner of knowledge and He did not franchise or patent that knowledge to one and not the other. Allahu Akbar. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was unlettered. He could not read or write, so that nobody could say later on that this person has read the scriptures from those before. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
نَزَلَ بِهِ الرُّوحُ الْأَمِينُ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِكَ لِتَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُنذِرِينَ.
The Qur'an was revealed directly into your heart, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so that you can warn the people. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had the Qur'an inscribed into his heart and his chest, subhanallah. And this is why he did not need to read or write. And he never wrote what was the verses of the Qur'an. Yes, at times he instructed certain companions who could read and write to write down some of the verses. And a lot of the Arabs at the time had powerful memories, and this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided to pass the knowledge on through memory. And we will never ever be able to do without memory. Let me give you a simple example. Initially, before the mobile phone came into existence, we all knew our phone numbers off by heart. Because naturally, man is created automatically by Allah. That when there is necessity, automatically he pays more attention to that necessity and he invents. So amazingly, we knew our phone numbers, our friends' phone numbers off by heart. I'm sure all of us can recall that time. Suddenly there came an invention of a mobile where they began to store the numbers. And now you ask me for my own telephone number, I might fumble for it. Allahu Akbar. That is a fact. And then what happens, one day we lose the memory of the mobile phone because it dropped, may Allah protect us, into water. And then suddenly we cannot get into touch with those whom we had to get into touch with. Sometimes it's a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to delete numbers of people you're not supposed to be in contact with. Subhanallah. Wallahi, it's a month of Ramadan. We need to learn that lesson. It is Allah's gift and favor when your memory is formatted. Wallahi al-azim. Sometimes in order to delete one contact that is bad company for you or haram company, Allah says, hang on, let me dip it in water for you. Allahu Akbar. That water will cleanse you and your phone. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. So if we go back to knowledge, we will realize that that knowledge is Allah's. If we had concentrated on our memory, we would never have failed, even if our mobile phone fell into hot oil. Allahu Akbar. Because our memory would have never failed us, alhamdulillah. You know that we recite the Quran in Salatul Taraweeh. It is impossible for any ummah, any nation besides the Muslimin, to recite their scriptures as we are doing off by heart. And alhamdulillah, you know that we have hardly made any mistakes in this month of Ramadan. Subhanallah. That is the power and the qudra solely of Allah. It is not us. Amazingly, people say, mashallah, there are absolutely no mistakes. We are flowing like the Quran is being revealed from heaven. Wallahi, that is the gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Man jadda wajad. Whoever tries hard and has sincerity, Allah will give it to them. May Allah choose us and make us from Ahlul Quran, the people who have the Quran, the people who will be the VIPs on the day of Qiyamah, whom Allah tells them on the day of Qiyamah, read how you used to read in the dunya. This is why we tell the Huffaz, don't spoil your Quran by reading so fast. Because on the day of Qiyamah, you will not be able to read in any other way but the way you used to read in the dunya. How you used to read in this world, that is the only way you will be able to read in the akhirah. So even if the world is full of Abdul clocks, you need to understand, take your time when it comes to reciting. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. For those who might not be familiar with that term Abdul clock, we mentioned it at the beginning of Ramadan, that there are some people who are not worshippers of anything besides their own clock. Every few minutes they look at the clock, the watch. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. We are standing in front of the Creator. We need to understand that knowledge will only come to us if we are ready to spend time to go and hunt for it, and to spend time to sit with it, and to spend time and money and effort and energy to try and receive it sincerely. That is when we will get the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't think that knowledge is just a fruit that you eat and suddenly it will be digested into your system. No. Knowledge will not come to you unless you strive and struggle and you are sincere. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose us for the right knowledge. So this is how the memory was there at the time. And people who had a powerful memory were also extremely knowledgeable, though they could not read or write. And we regard the term illiterate as disrespectful for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because it implies that they knew nothing. Whereas today you have people who might have university degrees, but they are not knowledgeable. They don't have common sense. They don't have wisdom. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not given them anything besides a piece of paper. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. And sometimes you have a person who might not even have a university degree, but he will benefit you in the field where others have excelled far more than a person who has a certificate. That is the power and the qudra of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember, many years ago, there were no even universities of this degree or of this nature. So the doctors of that time, they did not have certificates, but they were doctors. They were well known in the communities and societies. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really enhance the powers of all the doctors and lawyers and accountants that we have, and help them to balance their knowledge with the knowledge of deen. Because those who have spent hours on end in the universities, 8 hours a day studying huge books, need to realize they need to spend at least 8 minutes a day studying the Qur'an as well, and studying the sunnah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask you, you spent years on end seeking knowledge that only helped you for another 5 years or 10 years until you died. How much time and effort did you spend to seek the knowledge that was going to build the rest of your eternity? May Allah protect us. Sometimes we don't realize we study for 25 years in order to live another 25 years. We study for 25 years in order to live another 25 years. But we are lazy to study for 25 minutes in order to prepare the rest of our eternity. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us not lazy, and make us not from amongst those who cannot even attend an Islamic lecture within the masjid. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. Because the owner of knowledge says, if you don't want to attend, I will kick you out. If you are not sincere, I will kick you out. You will then be used as a tool to block the tafsir in the masjid. You will be used as a tool to block the hadith in the masjid. That can only be an enemy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we don't want that to happen to us. Anywhere there is knowledge, we need to make sure we are not from amongst those who are cursed. Those who are cursed are probably those who are insincere, and those who eat that which is haram, their minds are completely contaminated. They have no ability to think and distinguish between right and wrong. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. So the pen is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This includes all forms of writings. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decided that that will definitely be a means of the continuation of knowledge. At the same time, I had said Allah's gift dictates that we as human beings, as we become lazier, there are quicker means of learning. Now you have people in the Western countries, it is coming here as well, who hardly know how to read and write. They learn on the computer, on the screen. And everything happens through CDs and DVDs and online and what they call virtual and so on. That is a different way of learning. It's amazing how, subhanallah, we have become lazy. If you tell people read a book, they don't want to read. That is why we need to distribute CDs instead of books. Alhamdulillah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us knowledge. Nowadays what happens is, within our motor vehicles, mashallah, we have tools known as recorders or cassette players, CD players and so on. Let us use those tools to disseminate teaching even whilst we are driving. We will learn a thing or two, and shockingly, we will improve our knowledge, subhanallah. If only we use those tools in the houses and in our vehicles and in every other way. Nowadays, you find MP3 players and iPods and so on. Many people, including Muslims, are using that for music and for haram. Whereas Allah is going to ask you, you had an iPod, you had an MP3 player, you had a cassette player, what did you use it for? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us knowledge through all these mechanisms and that He has actually granted us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala thereafter, He tells us that He chooses those whom He grants knowledge to. You see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about that even in Surah Al-Baqarah. When one of the kings was chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the time of Dawood alayhi salatu wa salam, just prior to his time, and his people said, why did Allah choose this man as a king when he doesn't even have wealth, Listen to the verses. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
قَالُوا أَنَّا يَكُونُ لَهُ الْمُلْكُ عَلَيْنَا وَنَحْنُ أَحَقُّ بِالْمُلْكِ مِنْهُ وَلَمْ يُؤْتَ سَعَةً مِنَ الْمَالِ.
How can he be the king? How can he have the kingdom over us when we are more fit to own the kingdom than him, and he has not even been given a lot of wealth? And Allah says,
قَالَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَاهُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَزَادَهُ بَسْطَةً فِي الْعِلْمِ وَالْجِسْمِ.
Allah has chosen him above you, even though he might not have had wealth. And this is why a lot of the ulama, if not the majority of the ulama, they are not as wealthy as the rest of the community. That is a standard. Because the rest of their wealth, they will get it after they die. Allahu Akbar. That is a form and a point of consolation for those who have the knowledge of deen. You will naturally and automatically probably be from amongst those who don't have as much as the rest. Had you spent your time in business, you would have outstripped even the biggest of business people. But Allah acknowledges that you've used your brain, your time, your effort to study the deen. Allah will give you a handsome reward in return. Don't worry about the salaries of this world. The minute a person giving you a salary wants to dictate to you what you should say and not say, that's the minute you pull out. Allahu Akbar. The minute the people of this world want to rule you as a boss and want to treat you like a slave, that is the minute, if you have iman, you pull out and you throw the salary back at them. Because Allah comes before a meager salary of $100 or 1,000 rands. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And these are powerful statements for all of us. We as the Muslim Ummah need to realize the value of the ulama. We must never dictate to them with our wealth what to do and what not to do. They are meant to be delivering the message. We are not people of the book of the past who used their wealth in order to twist and change the Bible and the Torah and so on. We have the Qur'an, which will never be twisted. You either toe the line or Allah will kick you out. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us success. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us there that it is Allah who chose him over the others and granted him knowledge. Allah chose him for the knowledge, and Allah gave him a healthy body as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us good health as well as knowledge. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the knowledge he gave the various prophets. David, may peace be upon him, Dawood alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Allah says all the knowledge they had was from Allah. Allah, the owner of knowledge, decided to give them the knowledge. Listen to what Allah says.
وَقَتَلَ دَاوُودُ جَالُوتَ وَآتَاهُ اللَّهُ الْمُلْكَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَعَلَّمَهُ مِمَّا يَشَاءُ.
When David killed Goliath, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, David was the one who killed Goliath, Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we gave him wisdom, we gave him knowledge, and we gave him whatever we wanted from that knowledge. Allahu Akbar. It is Allah who gave him the knowledge. His son Sulaiman was also granted knowledge. Allah says,
فَفَهَّمْنَاهَا سُلَيْمَانَ.
Certain matters Allah gave the understanding and the knowledge to Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam. Regarding Jesus, may peace be upon him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, from the very early ages of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, Allah says,
وَيُعَلِّمُهُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَالتَّوْرَاةَ وَالْإِنْجِيلِ.
Allah is the one who will teach him the book as well as the wisdom, the Torah and the Injil. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who will give that to him, the knowledge of that to him. Allah chooses whom he gives to. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Nisa to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam,
أنزل الله عليك الكتاب والحكمة وعلمك ما لم تكن تعلم وكان فضل الله عليك عظيما.
O Messenger of Allah, it is Allah who gave you the knowledge of the book and the wisdom, the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That was all given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Knowledge that you did not have, Allah gave you. And Allah's virtue upon you, O Messenger, is the greatest. Subhanallah. Huge favors upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the best of creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about knowledge. He gave some who were not even messengers of Allah, such as Al-Khidr. Al-Khidr was a man who was from the Ummah of Musa alayhi salam, and he had a lot of knowledge We cannot say he had more knowledge than Musa alayhi salam, but we can say that in certain aspects Allah granted him a deeper understanding than Musa alayhi salatu was salam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired him in certain aspects with some items that he did not even inform Musa alayhi salatu was salam with. It is reported that once Musa alayhi salam was asked, who is the most knowledgeable? And he said, I am. This is a narration. Obviously it is a narration. We just benefit from it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I will show you a person whom we have given more knowledge than you. Allahu Akbar. And this is the story mentioned in Surah Al-Kahf. So the two of them went, meaning Musa alayhi salam and one of the people with him. And when they walked on the coast, there was a certain sign. At that point, they met a man known as Al-Khidr. And that is a beautiful story. If you'd like to go through it, you've got to read the Qur'an in Surah Al-Kahf. You will find it so beautiful and so amazing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
فَوَجَدَا عَبْدًا مِّنْ عِبَادِنَا آتَيْنَاهُ رَحْمَةً مِّنْ عِنْدِنَا وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّا عِلْمًا.
Amazing verses that bring tears to the eyes. Allah says, they then found a slave of ours. That's one condition of getting religious knowledge, is to be a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They then found a slave of ours. Allah says, whom we had granted wisdom and whom we had granted knowledge from ourselves. We are the ones who gave him knowledge. And amazingly, the story continues. The point is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught whomsoever he wishes from amongst the messengers as well as from the others. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how the messengers taught. And this brings us to a duty of the one who has knowledge, is to teach that knowledge, as we said at the beginning of this session. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he used to teach. Listen to what Allah says in Surah Ala Imran, though the issue of the teaching of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is mentioned in many places. Allah says,
لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ يَتْلُو عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ.
Allah has favored the believers by sending to them a messenger from amongst them. And Allah continues to say what the messenger does, and part of what he does is to teach the people the knowledge of the book and the wisdom behind the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The term hikmah here is used referring to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he used to teach. And this is why he says, innama bu'ithtu mu'allima, I was sent as a teacher. Good news to all those who are teachers, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us role models for those whom we teach, inshallah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us goodness. The one narration says, the entire creation of Allah has mercy upon the one mu'allimil bashariyatil khair, who teaches mankind any form of goodness. There is a lot of mercy. That is the power of knowledge. We need to teach others. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that you will achieve knowledge by being conscious of Allah. We mentioned these verses. I repeat these verses. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah,
وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ اللَّهُ.
If you are conscious of Allah, then Allah will grant you the knowledge. So if you have taqwa, if you fear Allah, if you are conscious of Him, then Allah will grant you subhanahu wa ta'ala knowledge. In fact, Allah says He grants knowledge to those who are good, to those who are muhsin. And muhsin are those who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the highest manner possible, as though Allah is watching them, or as though they can see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The consciousness of Allah is what is mentioned here, or what is of importance here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about Yusuf alayhi salam, as well as Musa alayhi salam. Allah says, and I'm going to mention the verse in Surah Yusuf,
وَلَمَّا بَلَغَ أَشُدَّهُ آتَيْنَاهُ حُكْمًا وَعِلْمًا وَكَذَلِكَ نَجْزِي الْمُحْسِنِينَ.
When he got to his peak, we gave him two things. We gave him hukm and we gave him ilm. We gave him the ability to judge and rule, as well as the understanding, and we gave him knowledge. Allah says, and that is how we reward those who are muhsin. Muhsin meaning those who are good, those who are pious, those who are conscious of their creator. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all the ability to be from amongst the muhsinin. Ameen. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that those who have knowledge and those who don't are not equal. So remember something. When you want to ask a question, ask those who have the knowledge of the scriptures. If that question is connected to the scriptures, don't ever receive or look for or hunt for the explanation of a verse of the Quran from a plumber or from a lawyer or from a judge of a Supreme Court. Don't you dare. That will destroy you and lead you astray from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unless that person is an alim who is qualified to talk, the person knows what he is speaking about, then you ask those the question. And the same applies to every field. When you have a problem in the field of law, go and seek the advice of a professional lawyer. Don't go to a plumber. And when you have the problem in the house of a water leak, you will then phone the best plumber in town if you can, and he will come and help you and give you advice. When you have a medical problem, go to the best doctor. So this means we will go to the best within the field if we would like to achieve success. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَالزُّبُرِ.
Ask those who have the knowledge of the revelation if you do not understand the clarity of that which we have revealed. Allahu Akbar. So if you don't understand, ask those who have knowledge of the revelation. Don't jump to your own conclusions. Do not just surf the internet to look for an answer, because there are non-Muslim websites in disguise that will give you the wrong answers, and they will make you from amongst the Qur'aniyun. There are people on the globe who say we only believe in the Qur'an, the Sunnah holds no weight, because there is nothing in the Qur'an to say we need to adopt the Sunnah. There are more than 10 to 15 verses in the Qur'an that prove that a person is not a Muslim unless they adopt the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But that will only be explained to you if you look at the understanding of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum of knowledge and of what they understood the verses to mean. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to contaminate our knowledge and not to make us from those who are foolish enough to go to those who are not qualified in the field that we would like knowledge in, and we will want to seek knowledge from the wrong people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that type of foolish behavior which depicts lack of understanding totally. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us thereafter that the people of knowledge are definitely different levels, and Allah has given those who have knowledge of this religion together with iman, Allah gave them higher levels.
يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتٍ.
Allah raises the levels of those who believe and those who have sound knowledge of this religion. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raise our levels. It is our duty to learn our religion. There are some things ma'lumum min ad-din bid-darura. We need to know them, fardu ayn. It is compulsory for us to know the rules of tahara, cleanliness, to know about salah, to know about the obligations. And yes, there are some aspects of the Islamic knowledge that not everybody needs to know. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this in the Quran.
فَلَوْلَا نَفَرَ مِن كُلِّ فِرْقَةٍ مِّنْهُمْ طَائِفَةٌ لِيَتَفَقَّهُوا فِي الدِّينِ وَلِيُنذِرُوا قَوْمَهُمْ إِذَا رَجَعُوا إِلَيْهِمْ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَحْذَرُونَ.
Let there be from every community a group of people who go out and study the religion to come back with in-depth knowledge in order to warn their own communities. Subhanallah. So a group of people, it is their duty that they make sure that they go out. And every community needs to have a group of ulama. We need to be worried about the presence of the ulama in our midst, and we need to make use of them. And this is why it is a test in your community. Allah has kept certain ulama. Your test is how you treated the ulama of your locality. That is your test. Allah is going to ask you what you did with those who had knowledge in your own city and in your own town and country. And wallahi, if you had disrespected them, disregarded them, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may overtake you with punishment. May He not do that to us. And this is why we always say yes when foreign ulama come to our own lands. Mashallah, we are happy. But at the same time, a hypocrite is he who has a good link with the foreigners, and when it comes to their own ulama in their locality, they are making their lives as difficult as possible, and they want to have a broad smile purporting themselves to be the most religious when it comes to people who don't even know them from abroad and from outside. Allahu Akbar. It reminds me of doctors. The doctors, they are specialists and they are GPs. If you would like to get to the specialist, you need to have a referral letter from a GP. That would be similar if you would like to be referred to a deep scholar of the deen. Your ulama from your community will then be able to refer you to those. But if you don't even have a link with your own ulama, it is like a person who wants to bypass the GP and go straight to the specialist. You may not derive what you need. Another thing is, how mischievous you are in your community, they know. And they will be able to deal with your problems. Whereas the outsiders think you are an angel. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And this is the hypocrisy. Anyone who gives greater importance to outsiders, subhanallah, they need to ask themselves, firstly, how is our treatment of those whom Allah chose to be our own neighbors in our own locality? It is not a mistake or a coincidence. Allah chose ulama of your community and He chose for you to be in this community. It is your duty to make sure that you understand and realize that it is a huge test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how they are even the knowledgeable from the people of the book. From amongst the Jews and the Christians, there are some who were extremely knowledgeable. Their knowledge led them to accept the Qur'an because they knew the signs of the Qur'an or the Prophet from their own scriptures. And this is mentioned in more than a few places in the Qur'an. Let's make mention of a few of them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ra'd,
أَوَلَمْ يَكْفِهِمْ أَوْ أَوَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُمْ آيَةً أَنْ يَعْلَمَهُ عُلَمَاءُ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ أَوَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُمْ آيَةً أَنْ يَعْلَمَهُ عُلَمَاءُ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ
Did they not have a sign that Allah kept with them the ulama of Banu Israel, the ulama, the Jewish scholars? Allah says they had the signs to tell them that this messenger is the truth. They knew that the book is the truth and they accepted the message. An example of this is a great Sahabi, companion of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was the leader of the Jews in Madinatul Munawwara, or one of their leaders. His name was Abdullah ibn Salam, and he accepted Islam. He knew the signs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ankabut,
بَلْ هُوَ آيَاتٌ بَيِّنَاتٌ فِي صُدُورِ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمِ
The Mufassireen say that those who have been granted knowledge of the scriptures from amongst the people of the book, they recognize the signs of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they recognize the signs of the Quran. Amazing. So true knowledge with sincerity will lead you to what is correct. But if there is lack of sincerity, even if you have the knowledge, it will make you duck and dive and it will make you head in the wrong direction. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all protection from lack of sincerity, protection inshallah from shaitan and his army. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the worst person is the one whom knowledge has come to, and after that he knows its knowledge and he knows its source, and he still wants to debate and argue. Allahu Akbar. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says here in Surah Al-Baqarah to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam,
وَلَئِنِ اتَّبَعْتَ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَكَ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِنَّكَ إِذَا لَّمِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ
If you are to follow their desires and their whims and fancies and what they have come with after we have granted you knowledge, then indeed you are from amongst the oppressors. Now, if that statement is uttered to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have a greater lesson to learn from that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns those who consider their brains as gods besides Allah. They worship their brains. They are right always. People who think that they are always right, they are heading for disaster. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
أَفَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَاهَهُ هَوَاهُ وَأَضَلَّهُ اللَّهُ عَلَى عِلْمٍ وَخَتَمَ عَلَى سَمْعِهِ وَقَلْبِهِ وَجَعَلَ عَلَى بَصَرِهِ غِشَاوَةً فَمَنْ يَهْدِيهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ اللَّهِ أَفَلَا تَذَكَّرُونَ
In Surah Al-Jathiyah, Allah says, do you see the one who has taken his own brain, his whims, his fancies, his desires, his own understanding as a god besides Allah? He's worshipping his mind. He thinks he's too clever. Allah says, Allah has led such people astray out of what they perceive is knowledge. They think they have knowledge, and that same knowledge will lead them astray because of lack of sincerity, because of the fact that they have tried to derive it for the wrong reasons. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Allah says, who will guide such a person? No one will be able to give guidance to such a person. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the examples in the Qur'an. He says, the ulama, those who have knowledge, will be able to understand the examples that Allah has cited in the Qur'an. And this is why in Surah Al-Ankabut, Allah says, وَتِلْكَ الْأَمْثَالُ نَضْرِبُهَا لِلنَّاسِ. Those are the examples that we have given for people. But who will understand the examples of Allah? Sometimes people will not understand the examples that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives if they don't have knowledge. So Allah says immediately after that, وَمَا يَعْقِلُهَا إِلَّا الْعَالِمُونَ. It is only an alim or the ulama who will be able to understand, those who have knowledge, who will be able to understand the examples that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives in the Quran. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Now let's move to something else. We had made mention of the fact that knowledge, Allah chooses whom He'd like to give it to. Sometimes a child has more knowledge than his own father. A child has more Islamic knowledge than his own father. Sometimes a student can excel his own teacher because he has learned in more than one place or at the hands of more than one teacher. And this is something very, very great. We still need to respect those teachers who taught us Alif and Ba, even if we have perfected our Quran later on, more than what they knew. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us protection. Those who want to curse the teachers who taught them Alif and Ba, just because they might have made a mistake or two when they taught them, they should realize that those same scholars were used in the chain of knowledge that you had been part of. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us. Because sometimes we have people who might not be able to pronounce things. This was 10 years, 20 years ago. Now today you have people, because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's gift to mankind of communications and the different methods of teaching and learning, you have people who can pronounce the words clearly. That does not mean you must disrespect those who taught you a long time ago. That is a test from Allah. They did their job, Allah will accept it from them. Now you need to understand that you need to do your job, and that is to make dua for them and to continue teaching. For every word you teach, they will also have a reward. Allahu Akbar. And this is the beauty of knowledge. The hadith says, when إِذَا مَاتَ ابْنُ آدَمُ إِنْقَطَعَ عَنْهُ عَمَلُهُ إِلَّا مِنْ ثَلَاثٍ. When a person, human being, dies, his deeds are cut from him besides three things. Either a pious child making dua for him, or either a sadaqatun jariya, something he has given, a charity that is continuing, a tree, maybe a borehole, maybe something of that nature, or knowledge that he has disseminated. It will continue clocking on his scale, inshallah, of good deeds forever and ever. Everyone who taught you how to read, let me pause for a moment to tell you some miracle. When I say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, there is a strong light, a power of reward that firstly I would get if I am sincere. For every letter I read, I get 10 rewards. Then everyone who taught me how to read, every single one of them gets 10 rewards each at the same split second that I uttered these words. And everyone who taught each one of those also gets rewards. So now it's into the hundreds. And from there, everyone who taught them, that's into the thousands and the millions and possibly the billions over the generations and the years and the centuries, until it gets right back to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahu Akbar. If you picture that for a moment, there are billions and trillions and quadrillions and pentillions and septillions and octillions of rewards. As a Zimbabwean, I know these figures, inshallah. There are octillions and nonillions, subhanallah, rewards that are going back at every moment to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is why he has the highest status, because he was the one who is the source of all this goodness, subhana rabbi al-a'la. Wallahi, if you picture it one day when you are reading Quran, or tonight, you will cry, you will cry. Your ustad, the one who taught you alif and ba, even if you are fighting with him now, whether you like it or not, when you say Allahu Akbar, he is getting a reward because he taught you how to read the salah. Allahu Akbar. Amazing. This is why you need to respect. And shaitan, what he does, he makes you disrespect your ustad before everybody else. Look at any community, look at any people, go to any ustad and tell him, ask him a question. Who has harmed you the most over the generations? Now we're talking about those who are teachers who are more than 50, 60 years old. They will tell you, you know, some of those I taught. Those whom I taught how to read and write, today they are harming me. They are making my life difficult. That is a sign of flop and failure for those people. And that is Shaitan's plan. He wants you to lose the essence of the wealth you have. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Successful are those who can respect those who have given them knowledge. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, above everyone who has knowledge is someone who has more knowledge. If you think you recite the Qur'an the best in the world, there is someone better than you, Allahu Akbar. And if you think that there is someone the best in the world, there is someone better than them. And if you think there is anyone better from amongst the Sahaba, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is better than that. And when we hear Allah reciting His own word on the day of Qiyamah or in the Akhirah, that is the day we will hear the Qur'an in its perfect form, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. Allahu Akbar. Imagine, amazing. That is the power of knowledge. And this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the source of it. In Surah Yusuf, He says, وَفَوْقَ كُلِّ ذِي عِلْمٍ عَلِيمٍ. Above everyone who has knowledge is someone who has even more knowledge. Whether they are hidden or not is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And above those who are most knowledgeable is the Creator, the source of knowledge itself. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us deeper knowledge, inshallah. Now let's move on to different types of knowledge. We spoke about the Sharia. MashaAllah, it is the most important type of knowledge, because if a person only has the knowledge of the Sharia, it will help him in this world as well as in the life after death. If they only have knowledge of this worldly material, meaning worldly, for example, field, it will help them in this world, and it will very little help them in the Akhirah if they had sincerity in it. But if they did not balance it with the knowledge of the Sharia, and they did not even know how to read Salah and Quran and so on, and they gave preference to this knowledge, then they will be from amongst those who will fail. Because they did not use their intellect to say, look, I spend so much time for this world, let me also spend a little bit of time to learn how I'm going to succeed in the Akhirah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expressing the importance of other knowledge as well, which is important on condition, as I am saying, on condition that we learn it, realizing that we need to create the correct balance, inshallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the stars and the fact that the stars are there for those who have intellect and knowledge to be guided with or by at night. And if you know, nowadays we have a GPS, satellite navigational system. Sometimes the GPS, it will take you through a long route, not because it's a female's voice there, but because of the fact that it is a computer that calculates on its own. Allahu Akbar. No, some people say, no, it's a female. At the end of the day, she'll take you a longer route. That's not correct. We don't believe in that, inshallah. But at the same time, what we do say is that if a person has the knowledge of the stars, they will tell you, listen, that's the route we are going to go. And when you are in the desert, or you are in the bush, or when you go hunting, people will tell you, inform you of what time of the day it is, just by looking at where which star is. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us knowledge. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَهُوَ الَّذِي جَعَلَ لَكُمُ النُّجُومَ لِتَهْتَدُوا بِهَا فِي ظُلُمَاتِ الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ قَدْ فَصَّلْنَا الْآيَاتِ لِقَوْمٍ يَعْلَمُونَ. Allah says, we have created, it is Allah who has created the stars in the skies so that you can be guided in the night and in the daytime. And Allah says, we have definitely, or so that you can be guided on land and at sea in the night. And Allah says, we have definitely made manifest our signs for those who have that knowledge. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us at least a little bit of all of that knowledge as well. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how He has created the sun with light, and He has made the evening dark so that you can count the days. Imagine if it was light all through. How would we count our days? May Allah protect us. He says in Surah Yunus, He says, هو الذي جعل الشمس ضياء والقمر نورا وقدره منازل لتعلموا عدد السنين والحساب ما خلق الله ذلك إلا بالحق يفصل الآيات لقوم يعلمون. Allah says, He has created the sun and He has given it light. And He has created the moon and He has given it a different type of a light in stages. So there's a full moon, quarter moon, crescent, and half moon, and three quarter moon, and so on. Allah says that is done so that you can keep track of the days and the months. Amazing. And the track of time, and you can take account. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us protection and understanding. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that He has given us different languages, different colors, different races, different types of dialects, and so on, for those who have a sound understanding to learn from that. They are the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We spoke about it very briefly yesterday, and we are going to touch on a different angle tonight. It is definitely part of intellect when you can learn maximum number of languages, alhamdulillah. And when you learn them like the people of that language, amazing. It is a gift of Allah. مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ لُغَةَ قَوْمٍ أَمِنَ مَكْرَهُمْ. Whoever learns the language of a nation will be protected from their plot. Because naturally, I speak Shona quite well, inshallah. And naturally, where people would not believe that, in the proper accent that it is needed to be spoken, inshallah. And sometimes you are sitting and people are talking about you, not realizing that really this man knows exactly what we are saying. You only have to utter one word to them, and they will be as embarrassed as anything. May Allah protect us. You protected yourself from them calling you the names. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. Generally, they call you Jesus if you look like what I look like, alhamdulillah. Because we are taught, really, to look like the Anbiya. And that is a very interesting point. It is part of knowledge. Let's make mention of it. Jesus, may peace be upon him. We Muslims don't have portraits of him because we don't know exactly what he looked like. But he did have a beard. And we do know that he wore robes. The Christians themselves, they are the ones who draw portraits. We don't know if that's right or wrong in terms, we don't agree with the fact that this is Jesus, no. But they are the ones who claim this is him. They've never drawn him in a suit. They've never drawn him clean shaven. They've never drawn him with anything besides a long robe like the one I'm wearing. And from amongst their own leaders, none of them or very few of them would actually have long beards. And then they call us the terrorists. May Allah protect us all. We are not, we are following Jesus. So why do you want to chase us away from following the same messenger? Your portraits we are following. The Mother Mary, whenever they draw a picture of her, they only draw her with a scarf on her head. And they only draw her with a long robe. They've never drawn her with jeans and t-shirts. Not once. So when we put on a scarf, they call us oppressed. Why do you oppress the picture of the Mother Mary then? Allahu Akbar. It's a fact. Why then does she wear a long gown and a garment? We put on the outer cloak and they want to ban that cloak and the scarf. They don't even have the shame. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. Really, that is a point for anyone who has decent knowledge, common sense. The person who doesn't understand this is a fool. And I'm saying that with a loud mouth, alhamdulillah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who can utter the truth, for those who have brains, who have an intellect, to see simple examples that Allah gives, and yet we don't understand. Allahu Akbar. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the fact that we need definitely to abstain from jealousy when it comes to knowledge. Because sometimes when a person has a lot of knowledge, or when Allah has used a person to teach, then others become jealous. Why is this person's madrasa successful and not mine? Let me try and find fault there. Let me do this, let me do that. Go and start calling them names. Tell them, no, this person is not a proper Muslim. Sometimes some people say, no, this person is a kafir. May Allah protect us. Sometimes people will go and say, they don't know how to read the Quran. Don't go there. Why do you send your child there? Why do you do this? No, that person, they have got bad habits. You know the history of this person. He was divorced, subhanallah. May Allah protect us. Really, all that is part and parcel of jealousy. Those who get caught in that, Allah never wrote benefit for them from that particular individual or alim or that school. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. We need to understand when knowledge comes, it will come and it will glare us in the face. It will stare us in the face. It is up to us to fight shaitan and to go and grab the knowledge. It is like cold water in the middle of the hot desert. When you see it, subhanallah, if someone is telling you, look, if you drink that, you know, it's not healthy for you. You are foolish to believe that. When you see it, run for it, wallahi, and have as much as you can. And if I'm with you, give me a sip as well, inshallah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Nisa, أَمْ يَحْسُدُونَ النَّاسَ عَلَى مَا آتَاهُمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. How can you be jealous of what Allah has given in terms of virtue to various people? Allah says, look at Ibrahim. We gave him so much.
فَقَدْ آتَيْنَا آلَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَآتَيْنَاهُمْ مُلْكًا عَظِيمًا.
We gave him knowledge of the book. We made him knowledgeable in terms of the deen. And we gave him lots of wisdom. We gave him wealth. We gave him lots of kingdom. We gave him authority. Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we choose whom we give. Don't be jealous of them. May Allah protect us. And this brings me to the final point of tonight. It is important for us to make a dua that Allah gives us knowledge. At the beginning of this particular talk, I intentionally commenced in a slightly different way, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us knowledge. And this comes from Surah Taha, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs His messenger, saying,
وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا.
Say, oh my Rabb, oh my Creator, my Nourisher, my Cherisher, my Provider, my Sustainer, my Protector, my Curer, the owner of knowledge, the one whom I'm going to return to, the one who gives me cure when I'm sick, give me knowledge as well. The owner of knowledge, make dua to him to grant us increase in knowledge. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala benefit us all, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who can make dua. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us sincerity and knowledge. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdih. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayka.